Officially, good morning. This is a public hearing of the Standing Committee on Ethics. The chair is John Sampson, who is running a little late. My name is Senator Liz Krueger. I represent the 26th Senate District, and I am joined by Senator Daniel Squadron, who represents the
25th.
Thank you, 25th District. And we're delighted to be here to take your testimony today, because actually the four bills being reviewed by the public today are in fact bills that Senator Squadron and I have introduced. Senator Squadron has introduced two bills and I have introduced two bills. Our first testifier this morning will be Attorney Jeffrey Perlman, the Assistant Counsel to Governor David Patterson. Good morning and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Senators, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to address your body regarding ethics. What I plan to do today is to explain the governor's proposal on ethics, his governor's program bill number 31, which was submitted to the legislature Monday evening, I believe, or Tuesday. No, Tuesday, it was a holiday weekend. And essentially what the bill does is establish a framework or a foundation from which to build on. So what I'd like to do is talk about that framework, and rather than get into the details, would be happy to answer any of your questions, but rather than get into some of the details of what is and isn't ethics, or what changes substantively could be made, I'd be happy to address, and I think we could have further discussions on that. So the bill does two things, essentially. It creates a new state government ethics commission, and to do that, to establish this ethics commission, a designating commission to select the commissioners is also established. And I'll start by explaining what the designating commission is and then get into the ethics commission and its enforcement powers. We create a new public officers law section 73E. It would establish a 10-member designating commission. This designating commission is essentially formed by the judicial nominating commission model. That idea was to provide for improved merit selection to find the most qualified persons to seek the position of government ethics commissioner. What we want to do is take away any one body's power through this designating commission of controlling the oversight of ethics in the state of New York. And we want to have high standards for appointing officers to the designating commission. So we set certain qualifications. For example, the governor's has, of the 10, he has four appointments. No two can be from any particular party, no more than two can be from the same party, and one must be a retired judge, Supreme Court judge. We also limit those who can be on the designating commission. No members of the legislature could be on the designating commission, no state employees, no party officials, no lobbyists in New York or lobbyists of other states. And we even take that one step further and say that no members of firms that derive profit from lobbying can be designating members. And members should be individuals, members of the designating commission should be individuals with some knowledge or experience in the field of government. These members would consider and evaluate the qualifications of candidates for appointment to the Office of Commissioner of Government Ethics. They'd make these appointments, as I said earlier, by an affirmative supermajority vote of the members, so that 7 out of 10 members would have to support the commissioner before that commissioner was appointed. They would fill the vacancies as they came about, and one of the things I'd like to note on vacancies is that in the event of a vacancy on the designating commission, there's a 90-day window where the appointing officer, the member, whoever that appointing officer would be, would have to fill that vacancy. In the event they don't fill that vacancy for whatever reason, the designating commission would be able to fill that position. And what that does is it keeps the commission whole for the purposes of voting and selection. A lot of times we've seen that in the legislative ethics commission, it's been 2 years now and there are still positions on that commission that have not been filled. This designating commission would establish solid outreach procedures to encourage the most qualified candidates to apply for commissioner positions. And like the Judicial Nominating Commission, we want to see how much outreach this designating commission does. So we require some reporting on what sort of outreach is made, quantifiable numbers, not necessarily who, but how many people are reached out to fill these positions. They would be able to investigate the qualifications of these applicants, interview prospective candidates, and provide for filling of vacancies, as I earlier explained. That's the designating commission. And so once the designating commission is established and they interview candidates, they would select five members of a commission on government ethics. And now I'll explain what this government ethics entity would do. They would replace the existing Public Integrity Commission and oversee and enforce the laws relating to government ethics and Article 14 of the election law, which is the campaign finance law. The commission, as I said, would have five members, and they would each serve staggered terms. So at the onset, when the five commissioners would be selected by lot, they would draw straws and establish the staggered terms, which would then evolve over time. The commissioners would, as I said, would be selected by the State Government Ethics Designating Commission. They would not receive a salary. They would be able to seek reimbursement for their travel and expenses. The commission would be authorized to hire counsel, an executive director who would also have a term, accountants, investigators, and other staff necessary to fulfill their requirements under this bill. This language, some of this language on enforcement and the part about hiring counsel, executive director, counsel, and accountants and investigators, that comes from language in the now expired Commission on Investigations. We took a look at the Commission on Investigations, which expired when the law lapsed this year, and saw that there were a lot of good enforcement tools in that commission that could be adopted in this new ethics commission, and that's just a piece of it. So the commission's duties would include the promulgation, adoption, amendment, and rescission of the various rules that are existing now dealing with ethics, including the availability and filing of financial disclosure statements, the granting of waivers and exemptions, the assistance to firms seeking to comply with the partitioning of lobbying funds from the remainder of their practice. I think that's something that's new in this bill, but there seems to be a lot of inquiries that come to the Public Integrity Commission regarding this partitioning of funds in a firm, and so we designate that. We also say that they can assist any state agency or the legislature regarding any possible conflicts of interest. They would be delegated with the authority to limit outside activities and govern honoraria, and they would also provide ethics training to those subject to its jurisdiction. There are lots of laws, as I've pointed out, that the commission would have oversight duties on now. They would review, investigate, and enforce the lobbying laws, the ethics laws, the financial disclosure rules. We also add open meetings laws by state agencies. The governor recently vetoed a bill that purportedly enhance the open meetings law by providing penalties, and this is one piece of his proposal to fix that situation. He felt that this would be another way where the Ethics Commission could work with the Committee on Open Government and have a little bit more enforcement teeth than the committee to go after violations of the open meetings law. And finally, the campaign finance laws, which is a big piece. But the problem is with the State Board of Elections being a split board politically, what we find is that they sometimes identify the problem but don't enforce it. And this commission would have the authority to enforce those rules and not be beholden to the political parties that govern it. Regarding the Lobbying Act, the bill does certain things. It obviously defines the various terms. It effectively takes the lobbying laws as they stand now, split among the state legislature and the Public Integrity Commission entities, and merges that in so that there would be one law for one for all state officers and employees, and not have dual parallel proceedings and entities overseeing the ethics of state officers. So the commission again would be able to conduct investigations, random audits, both the public officers, of all public officers. It would conduct hearings, both public and private. It would be authorized to issue advisory opinions and submit an annual report. I'm sorry, I was talking about the Lobbying Act, so let me go back. This is also, it would also require a registration statement for lobbyists. It would require lobbyists to file regularly, as they do now. It would also require lobbyists to report lobbying for grants, loans, and other disbursements of public funds, as well as other inducements of agency or public authority actions that are beneficial to their clients or themselves. It would, the prohibition for the receipt of gifts would remain with the nominal value definition by disqualified sources. It would make clear that placement agents who solicit the state or city controllers for investment of pension funds are required to register as lobbyists, and it also maintains the prohibition on contingent retainers. It would restrict the contacts as they are now for the procurement lobbying person. It maintains the 11-member advisory council on procurement lobbying to provide guidance to the commission, and it maintains the civil and criminal penalties. The difference being that any referrals under any of the laws that the commission has jurisdiction on would be to the Attorney General. I guess I'll get to some of the campaign finance pieces, but again, that's really just effectively authorizing this new commission to have jurisdiction over enforcement on the current Article 14 practices, and most of the bill just brings in the referral. Okay, I think that pretty much covers the bill. I would say that we took careful consideration to ensure that we don't impinge on any of the enumerated constitutional provisions. Both houses of the legislature would continue to have their ethics committees. They would be able to hold hearings and review the law and look at ways to improve ethics in the state of New York and do what the legislative body does, but they would no longer have oversight over their members. There would now be a new commission to do this. So.
Senator Squadron has a bill on a similar topic, so I know he'll have some questions to ask of you.
Yes, any number of them, and I'm first of all, I'm glad to see this, and I do think, and I've said this to you before, this idea, which I don't think exists in any other state, of sort of modeling on the judicial nominating process is a really interesting one. And so I'm right that it does not exist in other states.
No, I don't believe it does exist. There are, we counted 29 commissions that do oversee both the legislative and executive branch together. But this idea of taking the politics out, although the governor criticized the merit selection process in the judiciary, as we looked into this issue on that topic, we found that the merit selection process is a decent process. It depoliticizes it to a certain extent, and we try to address that in this current bill for this current commission. And it, by setting it up so that nobody has any majority on who gets selected, we hope to take a lot of the politics out of enforcement and provide a commission that does have teeth.
And I don't know if you had a chance to review my bill. It hasn't been submitted yet. It is available on the Senate website.
I did. I took a look at the bill on the Senate website.
Just take us through sort of the differences between them.
What I see is the difference, the main difference being that you don't separate the two. You have a legislative ethics committee, and then you have you continue with a new commission on government ethics with now 9 members instead of 13. Ours would be 5. You change the definition of elected official, and we like that, and our bill has that as well, where, you know, the way the law is now in the ethics law, you have definitions for all the various people. What we try to do is consolidate that, since we would want one approach to everyone. And we see that in your bill that you attempt to do that, to bring those definitions together. Your executive director has a term. Our executive director has a term. We thought that was important. I like the language that you have in there as far as removal, and I think that we have that a similar language as well. Your proceedings being on the record, I think, are important, and you know, our bill also provides for on the record hearings, both public and private. The investigatory powers in your bill are very similar to the investigatory powers in the governor's bill. I did see that you would include the categories of value in your bill on the lobbying provisions, and I was curious to see that. I guess that was for more openness. Our bill doesn't do that, but again, I'd like to, you know, I think we could have discussions on why you think that would need to be added. You have the way you set it up with the commission enforcing some of the campaign finance laws. Clearly, we have a lot of common ground on this issue. I think what you have is an extra step that our bill doesn't, where one commission would be making a referral to the other, to the Board of Elections, or vice versa. And our bill doesn't have that step. They would have they would work through their good offices, and the commission would not have to do any consultation. They would just be able to bring the enforcement measure. Both our bills repeal the Legislative Ethics Commission.
And the CPI.
And the Public Integrity Commission, correct. And back to the Board of Elections Ethics Commission relationship, I saw in your bill, and which is under current law, they have this it's an option, and it says that in lieu of making such an investigation, may direct appropriate Board of Elections to make an investigation. And my question is, what happens when the board splits? What if they don't? They just, you know, they consider it and they vote and they split. Is there, you know, there doesn't seem to be any remedy there. But that really was the only point that I had in criticism to the bill, other than to say that I think there is a lot of similarities to your proposal to ours on the merits of ethics enforcement, and again, we would be open to discussions with you on the merits.
All Just on the Board of Elections piece, you know, as I read it, actually, that there's a broader power in our draft. You know, I think it allows a reference from the Board of Elections, also allows it to happen, an investigation to happen on its own initiative. And you know, the reference back to the Board of Elections, I think is a legitimate question. You know, the issue is if there's an issue that for some reason the commission should, you know, won't take up, either because of its scale or something else, not letting it die. You know, I don't think it would weaken the commission. I think it might create an intermediate step, you know, before zero, arguably. Is there an issue on the governor's bill with an even number of appointees, and, you know, sort of leading to a Board of Elections problem when you talk about appointing the commissioners themselves?
I mean, the 10 members on the designating commission? I don't see it as a problem, but I think we would be open to discussing it. But because there's a 7-member vote required to advance anybody, that's really the number that you need.
And I guess the other question, and this is a more subjective one, the fundamental need here, I think that I see, the governor clearly sees, is that you need to have independent oversight. You know, in sort of both meanings of that, right? You want a commission that's created independently and then can operate independently. Both of these bills attempt to do that. Certainly, the intermediate step in the governor's bill is a new idea. As far as I know, a new idea nationally and how to do it, and as I say, a really interesting one. Is your view, though, that both of these bills, address that concern and sort of solve for the, you know, the hen guarding the hen house problem?
Well, I would say that the governor really looked at trying to get away from the fox guarding the hen house, and we see it now with the recent Inspector General report. You can see that there were leaks that happened by a gubernatorial appointed entity back to the governor, who was being investigated, and you know, that points to the example of the need for independent oversight. It could have been, you know, a legislative matter as quickly as it could have been an executive one.
But again, I mean, just sort of that fundamental issue, there's a, as I say, an interesting mechanism in the governor's bill. You know, again, my bill attempts to do the same thing, and I think on a fundamental level, do you think that intermediate step that the governor's proposed is necessary to get to independence, or do you think that a procedure such as the one that I propose actually does also solve that problem? Maybe not quite, you know, with one step less. But does it cross that line, in your view?
I think they both are excellent attempts at trying to depoliticize the problem. And what we've seen time and time again under the current processes are that enforcement is the most difficult piece, and getting to enforcement doesn't happen often enough. So yes, the answer is yes.
Right. Well, that's good to hear. I was I had to draw you there, but I appreciate you going there. Thank you very much, Senator Krueger.
Thank you. I guess one question: is there a difference in the and I confess I have not read the governor's bill yet, so thank you very much for testifying today. Is there a difference between your bill and Senator Squadron's bill when it comes to the teeth on penalties in any way?
I would say there are subtle differences, but most is common ground. There aren't any substantive divergent views in the direction we're taking, but the language is not the same. So you know, I think that you know, through negotiations, we could probably reach some agreement.
I guess I would thank you and urge that we do negotiate between the governor's office and the two chambers in the next few weeks to see if we can actually hammer out some kind of agreement.
Great. And I was just handed a clarifying question, so I admit I haven't read the bill either. The executive director has a fixed term in the governor's bill.
I'm sorry?
The executive director has a fixed
5-year fixed term. But I do like the language in your bill as far as, you know, reappointment. And, you know, your bill does have more detail in the executive director's appointment.
Defining what the fixed term means. Great. Thank you very much. I really appreciate it. I look forward to working with you guys.
Thank you very much. Our next testifier is Denora Getachew, I'm sorry if I've mispronounced the name, Director of Public Policy and Advocacy of Citizens Union. And I'm sure you will clarify the pronunciation of your name. Morning.
Good morning. It's Getachew. I was formerly Johnson, which was substantially easier, but took on my husband's Ethiopian difficult last name, and so no apologies necessary. Good morning, Senators Kruger and Squadron, and other members of the Senate Standing Committee on Ethics. My name is Denora Getachew, and I'm the Director of Public Policy and Legislative Council for Citizens Union of the City of New York. Citizens Union is an independent, nonpartisan civic organization of New Yorkers who promote good government and advance political reform in our city and state. I thank you for holding this hearing and giving us the opportunity to present Citizens Union's views on this important topic. New York's ethics laws are in a state of major disrepair, and if left unattended, threaten to further the public perception that elected officials in New York State are not only beholden to special interest groups, but even worse, are beyond the jurisdiction of the law's current enforcement authority. We applaud the Senate for seizing on this critical opportunity to engage the public in a discussion about how best to reform the state's ethics laws. State legislative hearings on pending bills is not only unprecedented, but is a much-needed change that we applaud the Senate for embracing. Citizens Union today testifies in philosophical support for the package of ethics bills being considered by the committee today, and I will address each bill in turn below. First, Senator Squadron's draft Commission Government Ethics Bill. I just kind of go through the testimony quickly because it's all here in detail. The current bifurcated system in New York, where there's a Commission on Public Integrity comprised mostly of gubernatorial appointees that oversees the executive branch, and a separate legislative ethics commission comprised only of legislative appointees that oversees the legislative branch, is the minority approach in ethics oversight nationwide, which Jeff Perlman testified to. Instead, like the majority of states nationwide, 29 to be exact, New York must reform its ethics oversight to ensure that the body is truly independent and that both branches of government are overseen equally by the law. Citizens Union supports the approach behind the proposed bill sponsored by Senator Squadron, which is very similar to a proposal assembled by Citizens Union, Common Cause, the League of Women Voters, and the New York Public Interest Research Group. We support this because it would eliminate the CPI and the LCC, the Legislative Ethics Commission, and replace it with a new unified ethics oversight entity, the Commission on Governmental Ethics, which would have jurisdiction for monitoring and enforcing the state's ethic laws for both the legislative and executive branches. The CGE's appointment structure would more fairly balance the interests of all parties subject to oversight by the CGE and hopefully address any separation of powers arguments put forth in opposition to the bill. We support the bill's requirement that either the chair or vice chair of the CGE be selected from among the appointees of the legislative branch because it will ensure that both branches are equally represented in the CGE's leadership. Citizens Union also strongly supports the bill's approach to empower the CGE to enforce Article 14 of the election law relating to campaign finance. We believe that it is critical that there be only one entity charged with evaluating the nexus of all intersections of money and politics, so that it makes sense that the CGE will handle ethics oversight for all state elected officials, regulation of lobbyists, and campaign finance enforcement. Citizens Union proposes a technical amendment to the current version of the bill to ensure that lobbyists registered in New York, in addition to those registered in other states and at the federal level, are covered by the bill, which it currently doesn't. I think when you took out the brackets, it seems like the brackets might have been in the wrong place. With respect to Senator Squadron's disclosure bill for public officials, we support this bill in principle. Because assuming no change to the combined legislative and executive ethics, the bill would require the CPI and the Legislative Ethics Commission to conduct random audits of financial disclosure forms that are required to be filed by public officials. The bill would also require public officials who retain, employ, designate, or otherwise do business with a lobbyist to file a report with the CPI within 30 days of the start of the business dealings. This report would require the public officer to list his or her information, the lobbyist's contact information, a description of the general subject of the transaction between the public officer and lobbyist, and the compensation, including expenses to be paid for the business dealings. Citizens Union recommends that if this version of the bill that's been in draft form is ultimately introduced, and keeps legislative ethics separate from executive ethics, then the bill must be amended to ensure that there are the same penalties for legislators who fail to respond to a notice of failure to file a financial disclosure statement. As the bill is currently drafted, Section 2 includes violations for those subject to CPI, but not for the Legislative Ethics Commission. With respect to S744A, the pay-to-play limits and disclosure of lobbyist-legislator relationships, Citizens Union has consistently urged for substantial restrictions on those who do business with the state, both contractors and lobbyists. Citizens Union supports the goal of this bill, introduced or sponsored by Senator Krueger, to reduce contribution limits for lobbyists, state contractors, and certain business entities, as well as the senior managerial employees and immediate families of such persons or entities. In particular, Citizens Union supports the bill's efforts to limit business entity contributions by restricting such entities, which includes those who own at least 10% of a business entity, any person in a managerial capacity in a business entity, or immediate family member of such entity, from making contributions above $500 for statewide office, $400 instead of my typo, $4,000 in the aggregate, and $4,000 in the aggregate per election for making political to political committees. While this is an encouraging step in the right direction with respect to reducing the influence of such business entities, Citizens Union recommends that the effort go further to outright ban contributions from these entities, which include business corporations, limited liability companies, and partnerships. Citizens Union strongly supports limiting the contribution limit for lobbyists and state contractors to $500 for statewide office, $350 for Senate, and $250 for Assembly. We are concerned, however, that a state contract limit of $50,000 may be too low a threshold for pay-to-play limits, especially when in a comparable system at the city level, the contract threshold is $100,000. The bill provides that those with state contracts cannot contribute for 12 months after a contract bid or proposal until 12 months after completion of the contract or until the elected official's term expires, whichever is later. While Citizens Union is not as familiar with the state contracting timeframes, the proposed timeframes in the bill may pose an unreasonably long restriction on the contribution limit ability of a state contractor, which may not be as narrowly tailored as may be necessary to obviate requisite legal hurdles. In the New York City system, for example, contract bid or proposals are restricted from the submission of a bid until 12 months after the bid and or approved contracts until are completed. Citizens Union recommends that the legislature further study this issue in order to ensure that the current timeframes are no longer than necessary. Finally, with respect to the Senator Krueger's S743A, the Personal Use and Disposal Requirements Bill, we support this bill because we believe it is necessary to clearly define how candidates can expend personal contributions. The current statutory language is very weak and leaves too much room for candidates' subjective determination of permissible expenditures. Creating a comprehensive list of permissible and impermissible campaign contributions will establish the parameters for permissible conduct. Citizens Union philosophically supports the concept of requiring candidates for political committees to dispose of these excess campaign contributions within 2 years from the specified dates. While we're not prepared to make a definitive position on the proposed options that the bill says how you can actually get rid of those contributions, we would much rather that you list, give the options of returning it to the contributor, donating to charitable organizations, donating to state universities, or donating to the state's general fund. We acknowledge that the goal of allowing a candidate to share its excess funds with a political party or another candidate may be a laudable purpose, but without significant restrictions on intra-party transfers, to put meaningful limits in place for such transfers, we think it is more appropriate for the funds to go to a more public purpose. In conclusion, Citizens Union supports in concept, with a few amendments as noted in the testimony, the ethics bills being considered by the committee to revamp ethics oversight, limit pay-to-play issues, clarify what constitutes the personal use of campaign funds, and require additional auditing of financial disclosures by public officials. We look forward to working with the Senate to incorporate our proposed amendments to strengthen the bills and to enact these bills into law. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a couple questions. Sure. On my bill, S744, pay-to-play, what we're calling limits and disclosure of lobbyists, lobbyists funding legislature, in one section of your testimony, you actually call for going further and having outright bans on contributions from business entities, business corporations, LLCs, and partnerships. And yet then another section you talk about that you think the limits for giving are reasonable. So I'm just a little confused how you approach that.
Well, I think Citizens Union has consistently taken the approach that certain types of corporate contributions should not be a part of the system, and it's something that we strongly advocated for at the city level when they did their campaign finance reform 2 or 3 years ago. And so we think that corporate types of contributions, LLCs, things like that, should not be included, but we do think for state contractors and lobbyists that there should be just be a reduced contribution limit for those types of contributions. So I think we treat the person and the entities as separate things.
Is that consistent with the city's rules?
The city does not allow any types of corporate contributions, and when they did their reforms in 2007, which at that time I worked there and I was a part of, they actually got rid of all of the LLCs and partnerships and all those types of corporate entity contributions.
Sorry, just follow up on that.
Sure.
Citizens Union's view is that corporate LLC contributions
should be restricted completely.
Should be restricted completely. So I just want to clarify. Thank you.
Got it. And just jumping to the second of my bills.
Sure.
On the personal use and disposal requirements. I understand your point about saying it can't be used for political parties or other political candidates, but the trick is people actually gave money to candidates for political use. So I guess I'm asking you why philosophically Citizens Union has an objection to these monies being continually used for political purpose, but simply not for the candidate who is no longer running for office.
I think the part of our problem philosophically with this approach is that currently, given the high contribution limits and some of the lack of structure or restrictions in place, it makes it easier for there to be, you know, these transfers that continue to go back and forth between candidates and parties. And so if there were hypothetically restrictions in place, lower contribution limits down the line, that might be something we would reconsider with respect to our position. But I think as the law currently stands, we don't think it makes sense to continue to allow these transfers to happen between candidates and committees.
And some other people who commented on my bill have, before we had the hearing, have raised a concern that perhaps 2 years is too short a timeline and have suggested moving it to 4 years. What do you think of that?
I think, honestly, in considering the time frame, it has to be more about what the interest is you're trying to limit and whether or not that's tailored enough to limit that interest and not going beyond that just to have an arbitrary time frame. So that if we think that people, or if you can prove that people are in the contracting process for a four-year period, then it makes sense to limit them while they're in that process. But just to set an arbitrary time frame is not, I don't think, is the
I didn't mean the contract. I'm sorry. The length of time that a campaign committee could stay open.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I changed bill. The length of time that a campaign committee could stay open when a person was not in elected office or perhaps not currently running for elected office.
It's something that we haven't considered, so I think we'd have to think about it more. But, I think 2 years is a reasonable time as it currently is set because it gives enough time to wrap up outstanding expenses or make sure that you're dealing with any outstanding issues with the committee as opposed to keeping it open for a longer period of time where there might be larger problems with what's happening with those funds and keeping track of them.
When I started to work on this bill as the sponsor, I was focused on the fact that we actually had deceased legislators with active campaign committees, and somehow that struck me as a little strange.
Yeah, definitely.
We, in fact, still have campaign committees that are active after the person who started the committee either is never going to run again or, in fact, has been deceased, because as long as there is a treasurer for that committee, it can continue. So as a sponsor, I'm exploring perhaps making it 4 years instead of 2 years, but I guess I would make sure to write in death actually is a limitation on your campaign committee. Thank you very much.
I think Crustin Estates lawyers would probably appreciate that too. Very briefly, in the commission bill, the concept here was to actually broaden the definition beyond just lobbyists to, as Jeff Perlman talked about, anyone who has any relationship to any professional relationship to a lobbying firm. I'd be interested in you guys just maybe taking a look at the draft again, because we do delete the strict lobbyist term, and that's in service of creating a broader definition.
Okay.
Political consulting and lobbying connections, even if you're not actually the registered lobbyist yourself. So do let me know if your view is that doesn't do that effectively, but that's certainly the goal.
Thank you. Will do.
There. And then just, I don't know if you had a chance to look at the governor's bill, but
I haven't completely read it, honestly.
Are there any concerns raised in your mind from the idea of the intermediate step introduced in the governor's bill, you know, as against mine?
I mean, as I listened to it today, it was something that I was thinking about, but I honestly haven't given enough thought to have a position. But I will definitely, once we've had a chance to review it, be in touch with your office about our thoughts, as well as the governor's office about our thoughts on it.
Right. But again, we all sort of fundamentally agree that the issue here is having a body that's not controlled by any entity or individual and then has the freedom to enforce the laws independently after its creation, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your testimony. The next testifier is Robin Barr, co-chair of the League of Women Voters of New York. Hi, Robin. How are you?
Morning. Hi. Good morning, Senator Squadron. My name is Robin Barr, and I'm co-chair of the New York City League of Women Voters. The League of Women Voters is a multi-issue, nonpartisan political organization which encourages informed and active participation in government and influences public policy through advocacy and education. We so much appreciate the opportunity to discuss this ethics reform issue that has been addressed through this proposed legislation and through the governor's ethics reform bill. Given the short time frame in which these hearings have been scheduled and the importance of the details involved, we will address the specifics of the proposal in our testimony in Albany next week. But we are here today because we did not want to pass up the opportunity to recommit in public our longstanding position regarding the importance of ethics reform that is subject to today's hearing. We commend Majority Leader Smith for his statement in support of real ethics reform, Senator Squadron for introducing ethics reform legislation, and Governor Patterson for submitting his own proposal. And we do look forward to working with you and the Assembly and the Governor to adopt legislation that will make New York a leader in state government ethics and improve the public's confidence in our elected officials. Ethics reform and campaign finance reform are terms sometimes used to embrace a series of overlapping reforms. Since 1954, the League has taken the position that these reforms must include a minimum package to provide meaningful change. Paramount to any package reform is enforcement of an adequately funded independent body with the power to conduct audits and investigate compliance issues. We have been concerned by what was seemingly the unwillingness of the governor, the Assembly, and the Senate to consult with each other prior to the introduction of bills containing disparate approaches to reform, and hope this is not indicative of a lack of commitment to these important issues. We look forward to entering discussions with all parties over the next month with the hope that a package can be agreed upon that will restore the public's trust in the institution of state government. A general approach.
That you are going to be testifying in Albany next week, and I guess I should then point out what I forgot to say in the beginning, which is this is the first in a series of three hearings. Tomorrow we're holding the same hearing in Buffalo so that it will be easier for upstate constituents to be able to come and testify. And then on June 2nd, thank you. We're having a hearing in Albany.
Yes.
And so I know that
we will be.
The League will be testifying
will be
as a statewide organization. So I want to thank you for coming and representing the New York City division of the League of Women.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And I do look forward to coordinating with the other
Good.
Bodies. So thank you for that point.
Thank you, Robin. And our next testifier is Chris Keeley, Associate Director of Common Cause New York.
Not just a constituent of the 25th Senate District, a neighbor.
Ah, well. Okay, you're going to get extra points, apparently, from
All
Senator
right.
Squadron. I will be watching carefully.
I almost tripped the senator on the way out his door last night.
That is actually true.
That is actually true. good morning, Chairman Sampson and members of the committee here this morning. Thank you for this opportunity to speak before you here today. Common Cause New York wants to commend the committee and its chair, as well as the two members present here today, for conducting these hearings, the first opportunity that we're aware of to speak before this committee. In the past, this committee has had a very low public profile. We do not believe that such a low profile serves the public's interest well, and we hope that there will be more opportunities like this in the future. My name, as you said, is Chris Keeley, and I'm Associate Director of Common Cause New York. Common Cause New York is a nonpartisan, nonprofit, citizens' lobby, and a leading force in the battle for honest and accountable government. Common Cause fights to strengthen public participation and faith in our institutions of self-government and to ensure that government and political processes serve the general interest and not simply the special interest. As the Senate considers legislation to reform the state ethics laws, four issues are paramount, all of which we're addressing here today. First, the legislation must establish a singular, independent ethics commission with jurisdiction over the executive branch, the legislative branch, and lobbyists. Second, the legislation must create more stringent financial disclosure requirements for public officers and candidates for public office. Third, legislation must limit contributions from public contractors and lobbyists, and so end Albany's pay-to-play practices. And finally, the legislation should strengthen the ban on personal use of campaign contributions. First, the single independent commission. Such an independent ethics commission with jurisdiction over both the executive and legislative branches would be a far more effective than the current bifurcated system, the bifurcated regime that we're currently under. This structure, the current structure of both the Commission on Public Integrity and the Legislative Ethics Commission, provide inadequate levels of independence, as the governor appoints the majority of the members of the CPI and the legislative leaders appoint members to the Legislative Ethics Commission. Self-policing is an eternally ineffective oversight mechanism. The recent report issued by the Inspector General is a public indictment of not only the actions of certain individuals, but the underlying structure in which they were operating. A single commission overseeing both the executive and legislative branches, as well as lobbyists, would be a far more effective model. Under such a setup, the commission members would be appointed by the governor, the four legislative leaders, the comptroller, and the attorney general, with no single public official appointing a majority of the commission's members. We've talked here today about the possibility of that intermediary step. That's something that Common Cause has considered in a number of different scenarios as one way to try to increase independence, and that's something that we're very open to discussing on this. We haven't dived into the details specifically in this scenario yet, but that's something that we would certainly be open to discussing. Such a single commission would more effectively and fairly enforce New York's ethics laws by treating similar violations similarly, regardless of which branch of government they may be implicated. The executive director of the commission should serve a fixed term, removable only by cause. That's very important, that it's removable only by cause. That's not in all of the legislative proposals that have been discussed here today, and I think that's something very important that we can't miss. Along with Citizens Union, NYPIRG, and the League of Women Voters, Common Cause New York proposed specific legislation to create a commission on government ethics, which would have ethics oversight over both the executive and the legislature. The draft bill submitted by Senator Squadron appears to be modeled on our suggestion for changes to New York's ethics laws, and we commend Senator Squadron for his willingness to propose bold change to strengthen and improve ethics oversight in our state. And we will submit our comments about the specific aspects of this bill through the online features on the Senate's website. We are happy to see that that's up there, and we'd like to be one of the organizations putting it to good use. Financial disclosure. Financial disclosures required of public officials must be expanded as well. Current law requires that public officials disclose the names of the businesses at which they are employed or from which they receive income, as well as broad tiers indicating the level of incomes generated. Meaningful reform would require additional and meaningful disclosures of financial background and interest, including the individuals and entities with whom they have business relationships, and the revenue generated from those relationships broken down into meaningful tiers. The piece of legislation today, touching on that aspect, does have new tiers added to it. We think there might even be a little bit more work we could do on that, but it's certainly going in the right direction. All business dealings with registered lobbyists must also be disclosed, and an auditing regime, such as the one laid out in the draft bill available on the Senate website, is a necessary component of effective and efficient oversight of improved disclosures. Again, we'd like to thank Senator Squadron for incorporating the suggested statutory changes recommended by Citizens Union, Common Cause New York, and the League of Women Voters, along with NYPIRG. Again, we'll submit our detailed comments for that legislation through the Senate markup feature on the website. The current limited disclosures leave citizens in the dark about public officials' business relationships. The indictments and imprisonments of a number of state legislators in recent years underscores the gravity of the problem. Overtly criminal activity by a sitting legislator no doubt would never be captured by an improved disclosure form. They're not going to disclose that they're conducting criminal activity. But what it would do is advancing meaningful disclosures of financial interest. It helps to create and to highlight potential conflicts of interest so that citizens can better understand the financial backgrounds of their legislators and potential conflicts of interest. As to pay-to-play, The public perception of pay-to-play politics is a scourge on the public's confidence in its elected leadership. Lobbyists, businesses, unions, and other entities with public contracts regularly take advantage of New York's practically non-existent contribution limits and placing outsized contributions into the campaign coffers of decision makers. This places a taint over the process of state contract determination and the entire New York State campaign finance system. New York should follow the lead of many other states and localities by setting reasonable limits on the amount of money that lobbyists and public contractors can contribute to candidates and parties. Lobbyists and contractors receiving public contracts over $50,000 should be subject to contribution limits. We heard Citizen Union talk earlier this morning about $100,000 limit. That's another thing that we think that that's a reasonable discussion to have. What setting that limit is open. We're not hard and fast at $50,000. And be required to report all political contributions within 7 days made to candidates and parties. Prohibitions based on the election cycle and the life cycle of the entity's contract, as has been discussed with the state, should be put into place to delineate when contributions are permissible. Again, that's an issue that needs to be calibrated, is what that would look like, what those time frames would be, how you tag it to the election cycle, the contract cycle. And again, we'll be putting our specific comments through the Senate markup website. Meaningful pay-to-play protection should prohibit lobbyists and public contractors from serving as officers of political committees that work with candidates, and prohibit the state, counties, and municipalities from contracting with entities that have made political contributions in excess of those limits. By limiting the contributions of lobbyists and contractors to candidates, and by narrowing the types of relationships between legislators and special interests from which conflicts can arise, the state can work towards an end of a pay-to-play culture and institute a fair and transparent process for awarding government contracts that the public can have confidence in. For that reason, we support S-744A as a needed reform. As to the personal use of campaign contributions, many of New York's potential campaign contributors have been disinterested in recent years after reading stories of elected officials and other candidates using campaign contributions as though they were personal slush funds. New York must take action to instill confidence that when a New Yorker financially supports a political candidate, it is in fact the candidacy. It is in fact the campaign that they're supporting and not the lifestyle of that given legislator or candidate. Current law forbids use of campaign contributions for a personal use that is unrelated to a political campaign or holding of a public office or party position, but there's a great amount of leeway in there as funds may still be expended for any lawful purpose. The public should be encouraged to participate in the entirety of the political process, including contributing to political campaigns. The legislator should strengthen the ban on the use of campaign contributions for personal expenses in order to return a sense of confidence. Larger reforms of New York's campaign finance systems are urgently needed, particularly the institution of a publicly financed campaign finance system and an overhaul of the enforcement regime under Article 14. But placing bright line distinctions on what are permissible use of campaign funds would assist in rebuilding public confidence and providing broadly understood rules of the road for candidates and sitting legislators seeking re-election. We support Senator Krueger's bill, S-743A, which seeks to provide further and clearer guidance as to what constitutes personal use. This proposal rightly prohibits, as a starting point among others, all expenditures for which candidates would otherwise be required to treat as gross income under Section 61 of the Internal Revenue Code. Thank you once again for this opportunity to speak. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Senator Squadron?
I'm okay. Thank you.
I want to thank you for testifying and also for doing something that I should have done, advertising the fact that the Senate now puts not only all our bills on our website, but the videos from our hearings and the testimony from hearings, and we very strongly encourage the public to use the website to make recommendations, quote-unquote markup recommendations on actual bills, and comments to us about where we should be going legislatively. And so again, I just sort of want to do a slight advertisement encouraging people to use that website, because you have hearings and only so many people can come, but in fact we do believe that through better use of the internet for communicating out and collecting information in, we give all 19 million New Yorkers a broader opportunity to share with the Senate what they think we as their legislators ought to be doing. And also just, you know, I think to your points in your testimony, transparency is so critical, and figuring out what we are in fact providing to people through these types of bills are so important. I think fundamentally the biggest question in ethics is elect ethical people. But the advantage of moving legislation such as Senator Squadron has proposed and I have proposed is we increase transparency, which means we give people the opportunity to take a look. And so not only by the fact that people are watching, but also our own recognition of having clearer laws that we can and should follow. I think it both encourages and supports the continuation of ethical behavior. And the other point from your testimony, if we fail that test, what we really have failed is the population who will turn off from electoral politics and who will be too broadly assuming that they have no role to play and that we are not standing for their best interests. And Senator Squadron is brand new. I'm a little older. I've been a senator for 7 years now. And I have to say, the most frustrating thing I ever face is people turning to me and saying, well, you're all crooks. And so I will do anything I can to work to make sure that in the state of New York, A, you can't be a crook and keep office, and B, hopefully turn around the public's, too many of the public's expectation that we're in a cynical world and that participation in electoral politics doesn't translate to an honorable profession. So I want to thank you for your work and for your testimony. Are there any other people here today who would like to testify? Hearing none, Senator Squadron.
I just want to thank everyone for coming and to echo what Senator Krueger said, and also thank the masses of people who are currently watching us on the internet. I believe we're being streamed live. And we really are serious about wanting to hear. In fact, I think that just in the testimony, you know, issues large and small came up, and similarly they can on the web, and we look forward to it. The fundamental challenge here is for us to create a system that lives up to the rhetoric and lives up to the requirement or the request that people participate. And if we don't do that, then they won't. And you know, at the end of the day, this is not something separate from electoral politics. In fact, this is about creating a playing field for electoral politics to work, which too often, as I've said many times before I was in office, and I'll continue to say, doesn't actually work. There's not actually an effective, competitive electoral system in place. And this is all about building that electoral system. So thank you all very much.
Thank you very much.
Glad we came here. Oh, great. I got a thought. It was expeditious.
Yeah, I know.
Expeditious hearing I've ever heard.